Welcome to the fourth episode of the Painting Buddha Academy.
Hi.
And today we're doing something slightly different.
Yes, we have a historic figure. It's the first time for the Academy that we paint something like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's a corporal of the 19th Infantry Brigade from the American Civil War.
Yeah, the 19th Indiana.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll talk a little bit about the history while you're painting, but... This miniature is from Fair Miniatures, from Fernando Ruiz.
Right, and he's done a really nice job on the box art. You can see it here. We'll go for something that is rather a bit lighter than this, than his color choice. Mm-hmm. So a little bit more bright. And but you can see it's a very interesting figure.
Yeah.
With a very nice pose and nice wrinkles.
Too. Yeah. Yeah, the sculpt is really, really beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And we've looked for some reference material online.
Yes.
Obviously, we found most color pictures from the reenactment scene, as in the Civil War, most pictures were black and white. If any, they were colorized later.
Yeah, that's true. There are some engravings about uniforms as well on Wikipedia. Very interesting. We can show them here. We quite get a good idea where we're going with the colors.
Okay. And today we're also going into a little different technique than usual.
Yeah. Usually my favorite technique is wet blending. But on a large figure like that, it's kind of complicated. And also it's good to show you another way how to tackle surfaces like that.
Mm-hmm.
For this figure, we will do mainly glazes and work at least on the upper part of the uniform. I will take off the arms so we can work freely on the torso.
Okay.
We'll start with quite a dark tone, so we'll take some black, some dark sea blue,
of course,
and some navy blue to get it a little bit more saturated. You can see on the palette cam I'm doing like a small gradient from dark blue to almost black.
Will you start working with glazes right from the beginning, or will you start with thicker colors first?
No, I will start just with the glaze right away. This way I can keep some of that grain to give a little texture to the...
Okay, that was exactly why I asked, because as oftentimes you want to get that grain from the spray gun, from the airbrush completely gone. Or in this case, it was the spray can, wasn't it?
Yeah, spray can.
If you have fabric like this, like a woolen woven fabric, sometimes it's actually not bad if it shines a little bit through.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, a lot of people have difficulties getting the light and the direction of the light right. By this simple method, by just spraying from with white from top and then glaze your way down, it's very easy to keep like a natural light on the figure.
Mm-hmm. If you actually base coat with a airbrush first, then the grain is going to be much, much finer as well.
Yeah.
Almost not noticeable. And that can help you really make some very fast pieces. Which blue are you using right now?
That's the dark mix I've done with the navy blue and the dark sea blue and some black.
Mm-hmm.
So it's rather dark, but... because it's so highly diluted, it looks quite bright in the light parts here. One important thing is that the film you're applying is covering all the surface, so you're not missing anything. So better just pull it over the whole thing. Otherwise, you have some stains, and with glazes, it's kind of tricky to correct them.
Mm. And I think it's important to understand the difference between a glaze and a wash. A glaze, basically, you want to make sure that the paint doesn't pool anywhere. You want it applied on the surface, whereas in the wash, you basically just put a lot of liquid on there and let it naturally accumulate in the little crinkles and creases.
Yeah. You can see here with the work that I've done previously, I just stopped at the seam of the close of the seam line here. So... little tricks like that to stop there is quite handy, because this way you can just stop your blending work here and then move on the next evening maybe to the next part.
Mm.
Yeah, you can see it looks a little different from the tone while it's wet. That will be more the same once it's dry. And you can see the glazing also works on large areas like that. You can also see those small wrinkles here. So once this is dry, I'll start with a second go to get like a really dark contrast. But I think I need the blow dryer for that.
So you know the rank of this guy, right?
Yeah, he's a corporal.
Actually, it's quite interesting. Lincoln in April 61 asked for the first volunteers to kind of fight the secession of the southern states. He only asked for 75,000 men for 90 days. So that's what they thought was necessary to actually get this done. And unlike today, the federal government didn't have the kind of the power to draft these guys directly, so that he had to ask all the governors of the state, and they then raised the companies. And also, interesting side fact is it wasn't really necessary to have any kind of military background to become like a captain, for example. A captain was somebody that, if they had a lot of money, they could raise their own company. A company was about 100 men. And then after the company was raised, there was a election of the captain, and usually the guy who gave the money turned out to be the captain, and maybe some of his friends that helped him became lieutenants and so on. So that's the way the company kind of was organized. And a company was about 100 men, like 86 or something to about 101. And 10 companies made regiments. So regiment was basically about 1,000 men. And five companies would be also called a battalion. So every regiment had two battalions of five companies. If you then combined the regiments to four of them to a brigade, then you would have a brigade. So that's where the Iron Brigade name kind of stems from. So corporal was a guy in a company. So the ranks were the what was it called? The captain. You had a lieutenant, you had a first and second lieutenant, you had a first to fifth sergeant, and then you had eight corporals. And our corporal, we decided to call him Corporal Horace H. Wharton. Enlisted on July 7th, 1861, and made it through the whole war. So you've been applying a second glaze now?
Yeah, but this time a little more controlled and just in the folds of the shadow, of the in the folds where the shadow needs to go. I just tried to exaggerate the foundation and the shadow that I still see from the foundation.
So basically, wherever you put the glaze now, you get more intensity and coverage of the paint, and also basically shadows already.
Yeah.
As I said, there was the brigade was four regiments, about 4,000 men, and if you combine then three or four of these brigades into one division, you would get to like 12,000 to 16,000 men. Three divisions then were a corps, which was about 36,000 to 50,000 men, and three to four of these corps then made the army, like in this case the Army of the Potomac, very famous army in the the Civil War.
So yeah, you can see I put quite a lot of the darker color here in the recess and faded it to one side with a wet brush. I will do that now to the other side. Some color on the brush. Place it there. Take the damp brush.
You just cleaned the brush completely,
Yeah.
made it not wet but damp,
Mm-hmm.
and just pulled the color outwards.
Yeah. I'll let me dry that so you can see how the transition looks. Maybe starting to look good. So another go up here. As you saw when he still had his arms, this area here will be covered with the arms, so here there will be a casted shadow up here.
Yeah.
So we won't go very bright up there.
Yeah, here it's interesting to note the direction of Ben's brush strokes. He put the very dark color on, then he cleaned the brush and kind of moved some of the paint a little as a transition downwards, but then mostly the brush goes back upwards towards the shadow. You see it here.
Yeah, this way I'm making sure the pigments collect here in the darker area where they should be. One thing why it's interesting to work on the figure just with glazes is because both the fabric of the pants and the fabric of the jacket is not so reflective, so it's quite dull. The highlights are very subtle, so you don't need to go there and put some straight white on there because it's quite flat on the floor. So you might have noticed I didn't glue all the accessory on there, because this way I can just freely move with the brush. Just keep in mind that you darken the area around it slightly. So see there, this recess needs to be darker because there will be something on there. So now it's just some black. And a wet brush to feather it out. And just with a clean brush, soften the outer edge a bit.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty much all there is to working with glazes, right? Applying the glaze wherever you want to have a transition, make sure that your brush is clean again, and just kind of push it a little on the adjacent areas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The thing is, with the glaze, you can easily overdo it and then you're too dark.
Mm-hmm.
I have a little practice with that, but if you're not sure with how to apply glazes, just do it thinner and repeat it more often. Mm-hmm. Another thing is, once you have the clean brush, just pull it over the whole surface, so you don't have a mark where you stop with the brush. Because even though there are almost no pigments in the brush at the moment you reached this area here, there might be still a few left, and you just see the step there.
Mm. So right now it's basically just water.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's amazing to see that with just, 3-4 glazes, you've really darkened the whole area already.
Yeah, it almost looks like the back.
Yeah.
Here I've also worked with some red, brown, and black glazes to get more contrast in.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do that later on here as well.
Mm-hmm.
Let me continue here on the smaller areas. I like that they are brighter than this part here because it pulls more attention to the upper part of the body.
Mm-hmm.
But still, it's popping out a little too much. Yeah, but I think you can see quite nice the difference between those two sides that were the same before, and then just one glaze with the tone really darkens it down.
Yeah. What else is there to say? I mean, the question is, why are they called the Iron Brigades, for example? Or why is this brigade in particular called the Iron Brigade? The original name was actually under the first Brigadier General Rufus King. He was the first Brigadier General of that brigade, and it was also called the Rufus King's Brigade. That was how it started. The Southerners called them the Damn Black Hat Brigade, as you will see later, because of the typical hat they were wearing. And they used to stand like iron in the face of withering enemy fire, and that's what earned them the name Iron Brigade. That name is actually pretty well known for in Civil War history. They also suffered the highest amount of casualties of any brigade in the Civil War. Yeah, it's not so nice. They had, for example, in when they fought at Gettysburg. Actually, I've been there as well, and they had the little marker, Culp's Hill. And on the marker, it said about the 24th Michigan, which the 24th Michigan was the last regiment to join the brigade. And that's why the Iron Brigade also has five regiments in there. Usually, it's only four. They just went there to replenish the severe losses they had already taken. And of the 24th Michigan, 496 men who went into battle on July 1st, 1863, 99 answered roll call on the next morning of July 2nd. So they had like an 80% loss. And the 2nd Michigan, I think, or was it the 5th Michigan, had a 73% loss at Gettysburg. So it's quite brutal if you think about it.
Yeah.
It's nice how much darker it's already with just another glaze.
Yeah, and I'm quite happy with the tone and the little grain still shining through.
Mm-hmm.
For the inner part of the coat, we'll just have the still some blue in the brush, but go for straight black in the tip. Just trying to paint it with the side of the brush.
Yeah, there's not too much definition in that area, is there?
No, you just need some dark shadow there.
Mm.
So, and before that, that's still some light color from this side shining here on the edge.
Yep.
So. Just a wet brush to feather the side a bit.
Mm-hmm. So the interesting part about this glazing technique is that you're not directly creating a blending of colors. You're just creating a blending through the application of transparent layers of multiple layers of paint.
Yeah, plus I'm using the shining through foundation quite mm-hmm. a lot. So this makes things quite easy.
So basically this technique would not work on a just white and definitely not on a just black foundation.
Black is impossible, and white just you then need to just place in all the shadows by yourself.
Yeah.
That might take quite a while. So I think if I start with just black or white miniature, I would definitely go for wet blending.
Mm-hmm.
Wet blending, if you want textures, you need to paint them. Mm-hmm. So here for that woolen fabric, this technique is just perfect.
Yeah. So you'll, I guess we can finish the rest of the coat off cam?
Yeah, I will
for
just...
For this step?
Yeah, for this step, I will just finish those elements off. And maybe I just put some base color on the straps as well.
Okay.
Because there's no secret, it's just one layer of base color.
All right, cool. All right, so you continued a little bit off camera.
Yes, I've just put the base color, the dark brown, on the belts.
Okay, which paint did you use for that?
It's a US brown.
Is it Vallejo air color?
It's air color, yeah.
Okay.
With a little bit of black,
mm-hmm.
so it's not that bright.
And what did you do with the glazes on the blue?
Yeah, I continued with the darker glazes to get a very nice dark tone. I've also added a tiny bit, you can see it on the palette, a tiny bit of blue. This is just called blue from Model Air.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit more vibrant, and Yeah, I tried to change the mood of the blue. It's
a little more saturated.
Yeah. It's quite nice to see how we can still change the tone of the color with thin glazes of saturated tones.
Ah, yeah. And you apply it all over the page, basically.
Yeah, but make sure it's very thin and it's not pooling somewhere. So. Mm. Yeah, you can see it makes quite a change compared to this side compared to that side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it gives a slightly more bluish appearance, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I think the nice part about this technique with the black and white base coating and then the glazes, just that it's a really quick result and a nice result, as you can see. It just really doesn't take very long.
Yeah, it's really a fast and easy technique.
Yeah.
Okay, so once this is dry, I think we will start adding a little bit red-brown in the deep recesses, so we get a richer tone. The next step is, as I said, the red-brown. You can take tank brown, for example, just thin it down because it's quite strong, and you don't want the red to be really popping out.
So you apply it mostly to the shadow areas?
Yeah.
And again, I guess the rule here is to be rather, to be careful and be on the thin side rather than on the too thick side.
Definitely. Especially when you change the color and go for a red on the blue, be very, very thin.
Yeah. And I know that especially historic painters are sometimes very particular about the color of something.
Yeah.
Now, we don't claim correctness.
So, yeah, I mean, I think it's important that the color really fits the mood of the piece you want to present, because it's a question of the color of light, and then for sure the question of color of the material. But yeah, the color of the daylight changes the colors of material so easily that I think it's really a question of more a question of mood than of historical correctness.
Yeah.
Yeah, I try to keep the red glazes really in the shadow and on the lower part of the model.
Mm.
So it's also a little bit of reflection light from the ground.
Yeah, like brownish or reddish colors are always good for that. And sometimes this historical correctness goes a little too far, I feel. I think the worst I've heard was a unit of something in the Spanish War that got minus points because the scene was a battle. And one of the judges said, well, before that, they were 6 months in the desert and the uniforms should have been bleached out from the sun. So things like that, where I would think, well, yeah, if you know that kind of stuff, then it's true. But it goes a little too far.
Yeah.
But I think it's nice to, because if you are going for historical correctness to some extent, really it's you're kind of learning about the subject matter. You're learning more about the history behind it and you're kind of researching stuff.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting.
Yeah, I think it's really easy to get carried away with the historic background of the figures you're painting, because it's really interesting and you have access to so much information. Yeah, I think it's so nice that you can combine the interest for a period with the passion of painting a miniature.
Mm. We can see how the shadows now get a very rich, deep, almost brownish tone to it.
So yeah, but I think that should be good because we don't want it to be too purplish in the end.
Mm-hmm.
As a next step, we should pick out the small elements like the buttons and the frame here of the jacket.
Mm-hmm.
And then the blue of the coat should be good, actually.
All right.
We'll add some white, mix it here on the side. Now, the complicated thing is when you now paint some highlights on, is that they don't have that grain of the built-up layers here. So you have to be very careful and either do like small dots to have a little texture there, and just lines.
Mm.
So, for example, here underneath the buttons. That was a little too much.
Is it going to correct it with the base color?
Yeah, it went into the hole, so I have to. Yeah, don't go too bright because as I said in the beginning, the material is not very reflective, so there won't be any like white highlights.
Mm. Oh, you've chosen to use mostly model air colors, I understand. Why is that? Why didn't you, for example, go for the scale colors on this?
Yeah, they're a little bit more satin. And I somehow really like the finish when it's a little bit more satin, especially when you have areas like that here. Those are quite big areas of brush movement and blending. So. It's easier if it's a little bit satin.
Mm-hmm. And also, because these are model air colors, that means you can dilute them very well without them breaking down.
Yep.
And that's obviously very good if you want to do glazes, as you really thin the color a lot at that point.
Okay, and maybe a little bit brighter here on the rim. On the top of the belly where it would catch the most light.
You can see also how important these small highlights are. They really define the whole fabric there.
Yeah. Continue with the same color up here. A little bit white to the tip of the brush, and although we don't have a border like up here at this point of the coat, I still like to add a little highlight to the edge.
Yeah, those are usually the areas in clothing where you also have a lot of friction, where the material is a little rougher. You can see if Ben uses the side of the brush there, not the tip. So this way it's not in danger of actually painting over the coat. As I've said so often, he doesn't just apply one thick line, just stipples, some highlights on there.
This part here is also, I think, quite important, so it would be good to have a cleaner highlight up here.
This stippling technique is being picked up by more and more painters right now, isn't it? Because it really simulates textures very well.
Yeah. And it's really easy because you're not actually not really blending.
Yeah, I can do that.
That would be it for the jacket.
Mm-hmm.
Once we've attached also the arms, we still have to check if we might need to adjust the contrast here and there a little. As the next step, we could paint those details here, but that will be in the next video.
All right, let's do that. All right, belt.
Belts. So yeah, more than just one. Actually, he's got quite a lot of straps and belts.
Yeah.
I want to make them like a really worn leather look. They used to be black, black dyed leather.
Mm-hmm.
So you might wonder why I started with the dark brown. That is because I first wanted to do some texture for the leather and then cover it with some black.
Okay.
So we have on the palette some US brown. Here you can see a small gradient from the brown towards the black, some dark sea blue, and some white. Okay, and directly a little bit of white to the tip of the brush. Okay, so we try to stipple on some small lines and small dots, especially towards the sides.
Mm. Actually, painting leather is a lot of fun, I think. Like how you build it up with the scratches and everything. It's nice.
Yeah. That's true. You're not really blending, and you don't need to make a smooth transition.
Mm.
And it adds also some detail and story to the miniature. Okay, so just a little bit lighter here.
And actually at this point you want to make sure that there's a lot of contrast in there, right? Because you'll cover it later on with more glazes.
I will not really cover it with a lot of glazes. But I will cover it with more like black shipped off paint on there.
Ah, okay.
So, and you will not see really a whole lot of that. For the black, I will use some black, dark sea blue, and a tiny bit of white. But it should look pretty dark, so almost black. A little bit more.
So you're focusing on the inside area a little bit now?
Yeah. So I have like open edges, like they're rougher. So I'm just trying to make small dots more towards the middle. I really like the look, but I think the those on the bottom here are a little bit too bright.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just wash them a little bit with the black. Okay, and now a tiny bit of highlights I will take some of the mud brown, but thin it down. And just glaze it over the highlight area here.
It's a little more saturation up there.
Yeah, it also binds the two a little bit more together.
Mm. Yeah, that's a very, very simple and effective way to make leather.
Yeah, I think that already looks quite good. I would do the same on all the dark leather parts, and then see if it needs some retouching.
All right, we'll do that off cam and come back with results.
Okay, cool. Okay, so I've continued in the same matter like I did here on the belt, on all the other belts. This one I've done a little bit brighter and just with lines in one direction, just to give it kind of a different look compared to the other leather.
Yeah.
To give it like a more fresh, more brown leather look, we will apply some ink, rather chestnut color.
But it's not the infamous original chestnut ink from Games Workshop, or?
No, it's flash wash.
Ah, okay.
But Winsor & Newton chestnut ink works good as well.
Yeah.
The nice thing about those inks, they dry off satin, so it even increases the leather look.
Mm.
A little bit more in the recess, and then with a clean brush, pull it out a little.
Yeah, two very different results from the same basis, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I like it because actually both look somewhat the same because of the texture feel, but still the contrast in saturation and gloss gives it two whole different looks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we continue up here. A little bit that glossiness also here for the shadow of the black belt. So that's it for the upper strap. I will also now do the small leather pouch here. It's very dark, it's hard to see.
Yeah. Is this from the primer still? No, you base coated it black?
Yeah, base coated it black, yeah.
Okay, why?
Just when I was doing the buckles here in black, just to not have it stand out in white too much.
Okay.
I wanted also to be more black, dark leather.
Mm.
So I'll work on the black base. I'll do a small transition on the black to when I add the texture over top, that I have like a gradient there. So black in the brush, white on the tip.
Loaded brush. Big shout out to Nicolas and Thomas from France that were here last weekend for their golden ticket workshop that they won last year. This year actually.
Yeah. So we forced them to do and practice the loaded brush. It actually went really well.
Yeah.
Here, that small round leather pouch is also a really nice part for the one brush blending or a loaded brush technique, because you can easily pull it over the surface and get a nice soft transition. For the first leather cracks, some of the US brown. And then just stipple around the edges.
So just basically the reverse process?
Yeah. Yeah, I think for elements like here where you really want like a small glossy look to the surface, it's better to do it this way around, because otherwise if you do the small dots of paint and then try to blend it, it's quite some work.
Mm. Very, very simple and very effective.
Mm-hmm. I think I'll give it a little wash of the flesh wash.
Mm-hmm.
To have more like a brownish leather, because this one pops out a little too much from the other leathers.
Plus, it'll also give it a nice little satin finish. I mean, it's just a small detail, but it really looks good, especially when you look at a miniature like very closely after you've seen the first impression and you look at all the details, you find these kind of things. It's really nice.
Yeah, also really it makes the figure look much more alive if you just paint those details nice and with a little texture. It's not that boring then. The next big thing would be the pants. You can see the pants are quite a lot brighter than the upper part of the uniform.
Mm-hmm.
We started with, in Germany we say pigeon gray, so it's very blue kind of gray. On the pants we will do a lot more classical blending than on the jacket before. Still with a lot of glazes to really manage the big surface.
Mm.
The grain here
yeah.
is a little bit too much for the fine fabric.
Mm-hmm.
Also, it's nice to have a little bit difference in the material if it would be not the same material.
Yeah.
Preloaded the palette. Here we have some ice blue. It's pretty much a sky blue, light blue tone. We'll mix that with some black.
Just to desaturate that a little bit, or?
Yeah, to give it a nice gray tone. We'll also add some white to the mix. Also to make it a bit more pastel-like gray. I think it looks quite good, this tone.
So I would assume that the first few layers are going to be covering much more than before?
Yeah.
I can actually see how this covers. It's almost the underlying shadows and lights from the base coat are almost not visible anymore.
Yeah, but you can see it covers a lot more. You can still see it in the shadows, but you really don't see the grain too much on the light areas.
All right, so if you look at the front and the back now, it looks very different. But you said I shouldn't panic.
Yeah, and I think actually it was quite a good question that you asked off cam, is why those colors look so different. And here I started also like I did on the front with a light blue and worked with quite some different tones in there to give it a bit more worn and dirty look.
Mm-hmm.
Remember here I've used some dark red brown. I used that also here.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the US brown as thin glazes. Those look more greenish now on the blue pants.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll continue on the front with another layer of the same tone but thinner. Because actually it's already covered almost all the parts.
Yeah, you can still see a little grain.
Yeah.
So we go for a second run.
So for the next step, I will just clean the edge here between the light pants and the, you can see I messed up the border here a little. Now just cover it and also pull it a bit here in the recesses of the pants. Just a little to soft out the border between the two elements. And some dark sea blue here under the belt. And with a clean brush, feather it out.
That's probably another thing we see a lot right now in miniature painting, kind of getting to the next level, is actually painting shadows that the miniature cast.
Yeah, I think it's good to emphasize the natural shadows a bit, but casting shadows are really, it's difficult, especially when you're having an open model. I mean, if you have it like in a box display, for example, it's for sure it's a nice thing. Because I think if you have the natural light and the miniature, and the natural light casts a shadow and your painted shadow is in a different direction, it's kind of difficult.
Yeah. It all also depends a lot on how the miniature in the end will be displayed, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we're painting with a lot of lamps right now. It's basically illuminated from all sides, so it's almost impossible to see shadows. But once you put it in a display cabinet, for example, or you have it in the show, then usually you have light from above. Which then, of course, will cast natural shadows.
I will start now to blend in some highlights here on the pens. Doing the blending work now, because this way I can, by glazing all the parts afterwards, I still have like a similar finish to both, or close to each other.
So let's load the brush again.
A little too much white.
Looks very strong right now.
Yeah, it is a bit strong. I was a bit out of the frame and it dried off. Well, I tried to get back into the frame. So yeah, we just have to stipple it out a bit with the more of the middle tone. Might still be a bit too bright. I'll work on the highlights here and then check it again. And I just mix a lighter blue so I don't need to go for straight white when I'm picking up color for the loaded brush technique.
What's the consistency of the paint now for that step?
It's rather thick. It's a little bit like a base color.
Okay.
And then I just soft it out to the sides. Okay, I think that is quite good for the first highlights.
Mm-hmm.
I will now start adding the red and a little bit dark sea blue.
So now we're going back to glazes.
Yeah.
I can note the direction of the brush. He's basically touching all of the areas now that are in the shadows and works his way up to a crease, for example, and pushes the paint towards that crease, towards that wrinkle. And that's really important. If you don't do it this way, you'll have really nasty lines and stains.
Just some thin glazes with the red brown. And you can see it already starts matching a lot more.
Mm-hmm. This is really very easy, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's really, there's only two ways to mess this up. The first one is that the glaze is not thin enough, which would look bad. The second one would be to have too much liquid on the brush and kind of starts pooling.
Yeah, pools are running all over the place. Yeah, that's true. But if you work thin, and I mean, you can correct it anyways.
Mm.
But yeah, rather work on the thin side. So now I have some dark sea blue, also as a thin glaze. I will add a wash of the US brown now to see if it starts getting the right tone. I think the contrast is already quite okay, but the highlights seem to be almost the same brightness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a very, very yellow part to it.
Yeah, and in combination with the blue, it gets this nice gray-green.
Gray, green, yellow, turquoise kind of
mix.
Do you also focus this on certain areas? I noticed that you didn't paint it all over the place.
Yeah, I also keep that more on the shadow areas, but actually not like with the red before in the real deep shadows, but more in the mid areas.
Oh, okay.
So you see here, I ended with the red here,
mm-hmm.
and went with the yellow a bit more here on top.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I think the brown tones here give a nice little dirt effect to the knee.
Yeah.
I think here it's already quite okay.
Yeah.
So might need just a little in the surface.
Yeah.
Also needs a little bit more shadow in the lower part of the leg. So we'll wait a second till this here is dry. And then I come back with some dark sea blue for some general shadow and then some yellow again or some US brown.
You're just trying to make the lower part of the leg overall darker.
Yeah.
Give it some sort of like global light or like a. Yeah, it's global light. Isn't it?
Yeah. See, it already got a lot darker here in this area.
Yeah.
And I think it matches now, though. It's quite good. The red brown again. know, it's dark sea blue on the brush, and I try to get into the really dark and deep recesses here between the legs. The clean brush.
A lot of people asked about this clean brush. So basically, there's two ways of doing this. You can either just make the brush clean in the water and make it damp on a piece of cloth, or that's the question I got from a lot of people, use a second brush.
Mm-hmm.
So just have a second brush in your mouth or in your hand, or maybe even a double-sided brush. I've seen those.
Ah, that's true, yeah.
And then just use the second side for kind of cleanup work.
Yeah. So, yeah, at the moment I'm doing just various glazes with the different brown tones, also to just give more color to the whole pants, you see. Mm. It really works quite nice down there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really like the really dirty look. Mm. I won't do it too much on the... much though on this miniature.
Mm-hmm.
I think I will add some in the end when I put the figure on the base. I will add some small like mud stains down here.
Yeah,
that could be really nice, but not like all over the place.
Yeah. And these guys have been marching a lot. I mean, they've been all over the place. If you actually watch some of the distances they cover, it's unbelievable.
So we will also add some yellow here in this area. But
you want to be careful, yeah.
Yeah, be careful that it doesn't add up with funny stains.
What you can already see here is that applying colored glazes, whether it's on these pants right now or whatever item actually you're painting, or part you're painting, it adds a lot of realism to any miniature, because you're picking up tones that you don't see in the miniature, whether it's a reflection from the ground or things like that. And these glazes are very, very easy to do.
Yeah, and it's really like that. Most of the colors just start to really work. For the eye, if you add either complementary color or other contrasting color,
yeah.
Here it's the red and brown tones, then it really starts to look blue because you have like the opposite to really make some contrast.
Mm. And if you keep your eyes open and just look at stuff, look at people on the street somewhere or in a room or so, and they have the clothing on. And let's say it's a blue shirt or a white shirt or whatever, and you really look at it very closely, you'll always see reflected colors from the environment.
Yeah.
That's actually something that I learned from miniature painting, is just actually seeing these kind of things.
Yeah, and this is one of the things I really love about miniature painting. It really changes the way you perceive your environment.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that is good for now. I will let that dry and do the same steps on the other leg off cam.
Maybe we can just show the difference again, how we started on the right leg or on his left leg, depending. Yeah, this one. You see the big difference between the front and the back there. That's how that looked as well. And now you see how it actually ties in together. All right. Okay, we'll let you do that, and we'll be back when both legs are done.
Okay.